Go. All right, we are recording. Welcome, everyone. My name is Lucy Gray, and everybody is welcome here tonight in the first, the second of several webinars that I'm planning for my technology and education course on staff development for National Lewis University. We're having these webinars so that A, we can meet face-to-face, theoretically, or kind of virtually, but at least see each other or hear each other. And also I want to bring the outside in for my students so that they understand what the potential is of online learning and of for creative uses of staff development tools, techniques, and events. And so tonight we're going to have our first guest speaker, Peggy George, who you see on the screen there. There's Peggy. And we'll get to Peggy in a second. We also have another professor here, Russ from National Lewis, who is here to observe and add his two cents. He's taught this course before, and maybe he'll give me some tips on how I can revamp it, because it needs a lot of revamping. And so anyway, without further ado, I want to go over a couple of homework things for the people who are here, Irene, and for the people who are going to be watching this. So you should be seeing my Chrome browser right now, and this is our course. And the first homework kind of thing is that module 4 is supposed to be, I need to post module 4 by Wednesday, because that's the start of our fourth week. And let me show you what module 4 looks like a little bit, just to give you a brief overview. It's not, it's on MOOCs, which are kind of a form of, and Irene's probably thinking, what the heck is that? MOOCs are a kind of online professional development. And I feel like this is a little bit outdated in terms of what we could do with MOOCs. So I need to kind of think this through. I thought I would have it up tonight, what the assignments and everything would be for next week, but I'm not ready. And tomorrow I'm talking to Angela, who's my technology and education department chair, and seeing what she thinks about this. But I really think it's a little dated, and I'd like to make it a little bit more relevant to everyone before I post it. So that's my first announcement. The second announcement is I'm going to hide my video windows here so I can see things. We have under content in our course, we have administrative documents, and there's the syllabus, which to me seems kind of redundant with some of the things that we're doing. So again, this might be revised slightly, but at the very end, no matter what, you're going to have a benchmark assignment is kind of your final project. And for Irene and for Kate, who is a special ed teacher who hasn't, I think she's worked for agencies before, not really done a lot of PD. I want to make sure that I support you and help you find an idea that is particularly relevant and useful to you. So what you're supposed to do for this benchmark assignment is develop some sort of web-based professional development thing. And Irene, I'm thinking that could be for the people that work for you, delivering, your cultural experiences in schools. How could you develop something for them? Or it could be for the teachers that you work with in CPS and that sort of thing. How could you devise something to prep the teachers before your visits to schools? And you have to kind of design it and develop and plan it and execute it here. And this may change a little bit because, again, I was hired very close to the start of this class to really revamp this. So just be aware that this document is here. It was last modified, several years ago, and it probably needs a little bit of updating. But you are going to be designing some sort of final benchmark project that's going to take into account the things that we've talked about in this course. So models of tech integration, characteristics of adult learning, that sort of thing. We want to see some evidence that you've put some thought into, based on what you've studied, you put some thought into this benchmark project. And I think tonight is going to be, all these guest speakers that we're going to have are going to give you lots of great ideas of how you could leverage technology to do that. So, and I'm trying to think if there's anything else I wanted to mention before we go. The last thing I want to mention is this week you guys are going to be using something called Participate. And Peggy, you're familiar with this, I know. And Russ, I'm not sure if you're familiar with this, but I do some work for this company in all transparency. And it used to be, to give you a to make this a long story longer, this came out of a company called Appalicious, which is based in Chicago. And Appalicious was a app curation site. And the founder of it, his name was Al, and another guy named Brad who worked for him, decided to do an education version of this app discovery site. And that was called Appo Learning. And I helped with some of the initial work on that. And then they really redid things maybe a year or two ago and rebranded it to Participate Learning. And again, I did a little bit more work for them and introduced them to a company called VIF, which bought them. And VIF is now rebranded with this whole Participate Learning theme. And it really does some things that are really different than any other tool I've seen. And I want to do a quick overview of it. So what my students are charged with doing here is they're going to find this week anything related to innovation and change. It could be in schools, it could be in businesses, it could be anything that might be useful to the class or interesting and inspiring to the class. I'm open to whatever people find. And they're going to create a collection of this content. And a collection of content in Participate looks like when you log in, you can log in with Google. There's curated stuff that I've done. There's also stuff from other people. So for instance, you could type in, you know, world languages. I have no idea what's going to come up. And you're going to see collections of resources from different people. And so for instance, and people have rated them and that sort of thing. Casey Taylor, I know, she's a teacher at the Latin school here. And so here's a collection on early childhood world cultures. This actually might be interesting to you, Irene. So I'm going to put this in, I'll put the link into it in the chat actually, if you're, if that would be useful to you. And so she's put a collection together with a little bit of text and rated these things. I don't think you have to rate them, of things that might be useful. And you can actually add any, you can follow her collection, or you can add this to your own collections. So it's a way of curating resources. That's the first thing. And everybody in my class is going to curate a collection of stuff related to change and innovation to inspire the class this week. And I there was a different assignment scheduled for this in the original syllabus, and I thought it was really dry and that we'd change it up a little bit in practice, doing a little bit of curation in this regard. The other piece of Participate that, and I know Irene, you're kind of new to Twitter, and maybe you'll find this helpful. They also do these things called chats. And this is what I think is really, 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 really different and interesting. And then I'll end with this and then we'll get to Peggy's stuff. So Participate has, so there's, how do I explain this? So there's people on Twitter are connecting, educators on Twitter are connecting and sharing resources and having conversations in real time. And asynchronously as well. And they're using hashtags like the ones that you see here to thread these conversations in Twitter. So you may see like around the Super Bowl time, some sort of hashtag and all the Super Bowl tweets are affiliated with that. Or you might see hashtags with, I'm trying to think of another example in real life. With election stuff or whatever. And that way people can find stuff easily. It's like a keyword kind of tagging system. And so in education, all these online chats have developed on every topic you can imagine. And sometimes they're held every week. Sometimes they're held once a month. It really depends on the schedule that the organizers decide on. Typically, they ask, 3 to 5 questions during that time, and people respond to it. So here you can see ones that are going on right now that are live. Virginia chats, Du Bois chat, museum education chat. You know, lots of ones, fourth grade teachers chats are going on right now. K-12 online conference is going on right now. Or you can look at a calendar here, or you can just see which ones are here. And we actually have one set up for us, by the way, which I think we'll leverage more in the next couple of weeks. So I'm going to show you one, what it looks like from one of my favorite chats, which is Global Ed Chat. And you'll see it under its alphabetical order. So there it is, Global Ed Chat. This meets every Thursday. And Irene, I think you particularly would be interested in this. It meets at, I think, 7 p.m. Central Time. And you can see some stats right here on this first window. There's, you know, almost 1,000 participants. There's, you know, lots of people are you know, almost 2,000 messages on here. And almost, you know, over 1,000 retweets. And it's moderated by these people here, which is actually, they have the same person is my friend Cleary Von Lee runs this Global Oneness Project. And then the Asia Society's a Twitter account is managed by Heather Singmaster here. So these are the people who moderate it. And you can see their schedule. You can add to your calendar. And you can see transcripts of previous ones and find all the resources that were mentioned. If you want to jump into the chat, you can click here. And this is your own little Twitter interface that will help you manage this a little bit better. Instead of going to Twitter and looking at 5 million tweets that are madly streaming, this gives you a little bit more of a focused space to work in. So these are resources that have been mentioned recently in Global Ed Chat. And people will use that hashtag all week long, not just on Thursdays at 7 o'clock. They'll use it whenever they find something that they think will be useful to people. And so there are a couple of different things I can do. I can follow people here that are other global educators. I can add a tweet here. So I'm going to say I'm showing Global Ed Chat to my TIE575 students. Say hello and let us know where you are from. And we'll see if we get any responses. And I can tweet right from this interface. I can follow all these people who are globally minded. I can also go through these resources and save them to my own collections. So I have lots of different collections and I can add them to there. I can also create a transcript and create a collection on the fly. So this is like one-stop shopping for managing these Twitter chats, which are, have turned out to be really powerful ways to collaborate and connect with other educators around the world. And we could spend a lot of time talking about them, but what I suggest you do if you're a little overwhelmed by this is just to play with it. And you're going to dive in a little bit this week by creating a collection of materials around innovation and change. Oh, look, there's Peggy. Peggy already said hello, and you can see it popping up in there. Good. Peggy's on the ball. So anyway, I just want to make sure that I showed you, you know, a little bit about what we're doing in our course, a little bit about thinking about your benchmark project, and we'll do more about that in the next couple of weeks. And then I wanted to make sure that you understood how to use participate. I wanted to go over that before I turn this over to Peggy. So without further ado, I'm going to stop sharing and introduce you to my friend Peggy. So Peggy, I've known for, I don't know, maybe 10 years now. How long do you think it's been, Peggy? I don't hear you. Why do I not hear you?
Well, it would help if I unmuted my microphone. It's been at least that long.
Yeah.
Maybe 2007?
Yeah, 6 or 7, I think.
Yeah.
So to make a long story short, things became much more collaborative and amongst educators around that time. People started blogging and sharing their blogs. Twitter was invented about 2007. I've probably known Russ almost as long because he and I were in a program at U of C way back when, about the same time. So it was a pretty exciting time. And the reason I wanted, Peggy's a former principal who lives in Arizona, and she'll tell you more about herself. But she's, there's so many online things that are going on right now in terms of professional development that are free, that you can attend in live like this or asynchronously. And Peggy's at all of them. I think she clones herself and makes herself available at them. And so I wanted her to kind of share her story and her experiences about what online learning is like and what it's done for her professionally. And she's one of the most professionally generous people I know. She helps out with online events that I run, and she's always pleasant and a role model for everybody out there. So without further ado, I'm gonna turn it over to Peggy and have her share her story. Thanks for coming, Peggy.
Well, you're welcome. Thanks for inviting me. It is a long story, and it's one that I'm very excited about. When I first started on Twitter, I had no idea where that was going to lead me. But what I've discovered over the years is that I have been able to connect with educators around the world and to do so many things with them, learning from them, sharing with them, all for free. And I host a regular weekly webinar for teachers called Classroom 2.0 Live. And that came about because Steve Hargadon has been my mentor and guru forever. And right from the very beginning, I used to tune in and listen to him do a little audio broadcast. It was basically a podcast on Saturdays. And I one time said, these are so interesting. If you would just tell us ahead of time what you're going to be talking about, we could all come prepared with some things, some ideas to share. And he said, well, that's a terrific idea. Why don't you do that? So I had my new job. And I had just retired. I was a principal for over 25 years. And then I taught at the university, at Arizona State University, for another 7 years, primarily in teacher education. And I managed and directed a teacher education program called a professional development school program. So I wasn't ready to stop doing all those things, but I was ready to stop going to work every day. So I started Classroom 2.0 Live. We just celebrated our 8th anniversary about 3 weeks ago, which is quite a milestone. We've done about a little over 300 webinars. And through that process, I have realized how difficult it is for teachers to find ways to get involved with free professional development, because heaven knows they don't have the money to spend out of their own pockets. They're lucky if they have the time to do it. But I knew that it was really important to them. So what I did was I created a live binder. I'm going to say a little bit about the live binder. I'm going to actually share my screen for that. But I created a live binder that is just loaded with hundreds of links to free webinars, free virtual conferences, and all kinds of free tools and resources that you can use as a teacher either to share or to learn. And I want to do a little guided tour through my live binder. As it turns out, I just did a webinar presentation on this on Classroom 2.0 Live last Saturday, because my friend Kim Thomas from Phoenix also and I decided it would be fun to share that work with them. So we took turns sharing about it. So I'd like to share that with you to show you what an awesome tool LiveBinders are and how you can use this to find resources that might help you with some of those projects that you're going to be working on. It includes links to actual sites where you can join a webinar or join a conference, but also where you can watch recordings of previous conferences. And sometimes that's what you need. And being on demand is what makes it so valuable, because you don't have to show up at a specific time, although sometimes you can, and be a part of the live conversation. But if you can't do that, then you need the option to be able to choose the topic you want to learn about and the time you want to learn it. And the great thing, obviously, about a recording is you can pause it anytime you like, anywhere along the way. So Lucy shared the link to the live binder that I'm going to share with you in the chat, and I'm going to take you to my live binder. Let's see. And I'm hoping that you're all seeing this now. Obviously, I won't be able to see the chat right now, but live binders are amazing tools. I love Participate for the collections that you can get, but there isn't a way to organize things into categories or folders or topics. And that's one of the reasons I really love live binders. So you can see that the whole focus for this particular live binder is all about growing your PLN and finding ways to learn and share professionally. And so I put this slide in here with a quote from Stephen Downs, because I think this is the heart of the matter, that we need to realize that education isn't something that's provided for us, and more towards the idea that education is something we create for ourselves. And that's the real value of choosing your own path for professional learning. So in this live binder, we started with a slide. We actually made a credit card for people. And if you know the value of credit cards, you know that they often have limits on them. And this particular credit card is one that has no limit. It's a credit card to charge up your PLN. And there's not only no limit on the amount of, quote, money that you might use, but it never expires. So just conceptually, we wanted to take that idea out and to say, here are some great ways that you can learn professionally on demand. And you can see here in the description that teachers need high quality, no cost or very low cost alternatives, and that they have to be flexible and meet the needs of teachers. You often hear it called PD on demand. So in this live binder, and one of the wonderful things about a live binder is you can add a table of contents. And the cool thing is every one of these things are automatically added. I didn't have to create this table of contents. All I did was create the tabs, and it picked up all the tabs and subtabs, and every one of these things are a link to a resource. And they may be webinars, they may be virtual conferences, they may be teaching resources, free lesson plans, things like that. I included a bunch of things related to Twitter and TweetDeck with some tutorial kinds of things, some resources. I also included things like Periscope. That is becoming a really popular way to share. And it's very informal, but teachers are hopping on there all the time to share something they're doing with their class or something they're doing with other teachers or to announce an upcoming event. All great things. So those, if you wanted a quick overview of everything that's in my live binder, all you have to do is scroll down the table of contents and you'll see the range, the wide range of things there. In the live binder's information, I really wanted to include that. It's a combination of tutorials and examples of live binders that have been created by teachers to share professional resources, to share lesson plans and unit plans, but also students with instructions for how to do all of those things. So if you were to decide after you've learned more about live binders, that that might be a great way for you to share the resources and the research that you're collecting. There will be a lot of tutorial instructions in this section that could help you do that. And then at the very bottom, I actually have the presentation slides and the recording of the session that we did. So you could listen to that if you wanted to. This tab, notice how when I click on that tab, it opens up into a whole bunch of sub-tabs. All of these things were in that table of contents, but every one of these things are places where you can find free webinars. And of course, I always want to start with Classroom 2.0 Live because that's my webinar. And we not only hold it every week on Saturdays, but we also always record it. So it gets posted on YouTube. It gets posted on iTunes U, and then we keep the blog post in our archives where you can actually read the description of the presentation and then click on any of the links that you like. I create a live binder for every show that we do, and all of the archives of all of our live binders are here. So if you saw a topic, for example, this one was early last year, was on global Google mapping. It was a fantastic presentation by Kathy Beck, and we created a live binder for all of her resources. So if you wanted to see those, you would just click on the link. This happens to be an image of that, but inside the live binder, if you click on that link, you will be able to go to her presentation and then access all of her links. There are a lot of people that I have followed for years. One of the fun things I really like to do is to participate in webinars and meet people that are there, and they often are asking questions and sharing information about themselves. And I have met so many great educators, and often what I will do after the webinar is over, if I was really impressed with it and really loved what they had to share, I'll contact them, because they usually share their Twitter ID or some way to contact them, and I'll ask them, would you be willing to come and do that same presentation for us on Classroom 2.0 Live? And I have never been turned down. So I'm so glad that I have those opportunities to connect with other people who are as passionate as I am about some of these things and who are willing to come and continue to share with other teachers. One of my favorites is the edweb.net community, and actually it's a whole bunch of communities, and they have maybe 3 to 5 webinars every week, and they're all free. And all you have to do is log in at the time of the webinar, and you can participate in the chat, or you can just sit and listen if you prefer to do that. And you can check out, they have a calendar, so you can actually check out their calendar and see what's coming up that next week. What I like to do is go to the calendar at the beginning of the week, and I see what's coming up. And if I think it's a session I'd really like to go to, then I directly add it to my Google Calendar. So that way, I won't miss it. I'll get my little Google Calendar alert reminding me, and I'll be able to go and watch it live. But if I have to miss it and I'm really interested in it, I know that I can go back to that same link on the following day and watch the recording for free. And they use a process where if you watch the recording, you have to answer a few questions about the presentation, and then you can get a PD certificate. There are a lot of the webinars that don't offer PD certificates. We do on Classroom 2.0 Live, and it's for everything, whether you watch a live show or a recorded show. And all you have to do is fill in a survey indicating that you'd like to have one, and you can get a PD certificate. So I would really encourage you to check out EdWeb communities. I probably am involved in at least maybe 40 communities. And when you join a community, it's more than just a bunch of webinars, but it's a bunch of people who are interested in that topic who communicate on their blog. So you can ask a question. You can ask for people to share projects if they say they're working on something. So it's a community in addition to a webinar. And like I say, there are maybe 3 to 5 webinars every week. Some days have 2 or 3 in a single day. And when you go into these communities, I'm not sure. I'm going to see if I can log in straight. One thing I love about LiveBinders is that you can actually go directly to a website from within the LiveBinder, so you don't have to log out and open up another new tab. It's showing here on this homepage what are some of the webinars that are coming up. But they have a new teacher community that is great for people that not only are new teachers, but people who are working with new teachers. So if you're a professional coach and you would like to find resources to support your teachers, you can just join that community. You'll get notified of their webinars, and you'll also get notifications of the conversation that's going on in the community. So I would encourage you to check those out. Some of the other things that I have in here are one-time things. Some of them are occasional things. All of them are free. However, if you have heard of Simple K-12, their live webinars are often free to watch. They run about 30 minutes. But you can't watch the recording unless you join the community, and that costs money. So you just need to be aware of that. If there's a topic coming up that you're interested in, but you're not a member of the community, just make sure you get in there and watch it live. There are some awesome presenters, and I always learn so much by going to them. And I don't join too many of these subscription services that you have to pay for, because I'm retired and I have to pay for everything on my own, as many teachers do. So, but Simple K-12 webinars are one of the things I do pay for. And the reason I do that, and you have to make this judgment on your own, but the reason I do that is I want to be able to go back and re-watch the webinars. So often they are tutorials, and they provide links and resources that I really want to access. And you can't do that if you're not a member. So I want to be able to go back and pause it, try things out, and continue to watch it. So that's just a little bit about that. There's also an administrative community in Simple K-12. And I don't know, it doesn't look like that image is going to come up there. Oh, there it comes. So there are many communities in Simple K-12, and you should explore those if you have a special interest to see what they have and what's coming up. I'm just scrolling slowly down through these webinars so you get an idea about some of them. Some of them are non-education webinars, but they are really valuable. If you haven't ever heard of the Training Magazine Network, they have free webinars every week. And many of them have to do with business, but they apply to education too. So they may be presenting on how to make a powerful PowerPoint presentation or something like that. And you just need to check it out. They've had some wonderful ones on gamification. I thought this one looked really interesting. This just came up this last week on microlearning and gamification about research and how to put it into practice. So you can see those are things that are directly relevant to education. So that might be a link you might want to check out and actually go to their site. This is just an image of what's on that site. But I always put the link, the direct link to the resource up at the top of the image. so that you can go directly to the site and find it. A number of these are recordings of webinars. I also have attended Ken Blanchard webinars, and he has been an educator all of his lifetime. And while he is a huge leader in business and organizations, he's a real leader in situational leadership. So he has great resources there, and he does about one free webinar a month that you can go to. And some of them, as you can see on this one, are on demand. So that means that you could watch it anytime. Some of them are webinars that you can participate in, and some are ones that you just listen to. So BAM Radio Network has tons of great podcasts. I call them podcasts because they're audio. And you can look at those that are for teachers, for leaders, or ed tech. And when you go to those, there'll be a brief intro, usually a description of what it's all about, and then you'll listen to it. They're usually under 20 minutes, and I find it just a really valuable place to go to learn some things. I'm just scrolling here a little bit. You can see some of their featured programs, and many of these are people that I follow all the time, and I get notified when their shows are coming up. So that's enough about webinars, but please take some time to click on that link and go explore what's in there to see if there's something that you might find interesting. The next tab I have, and you can see there are a whole lot of sub-tabs under here, are free virtual conferences. Lucy is responsible for many of these, and probably was one of the very first ones I got started with was Global Ed Conference. But Steve Hargadon hosts many of these virtual conferences, and some of them are not active right now, but there are some coming up, like the Student Technology Conference is a conference that is all presented by students. And I'm really looking forward to that. I think that's in March. But you'll see a whole bunch of examples of different conferences. This is the Global Education Conference. Again, just click on the link, go check it out, and you'll always find recordings as well as information about the conference. So that's another great way to tune in to what people are talking about. And that one's especially valuable because you know you're going to be meeting up and hearing from educators from around the world. You know, they're not just in your hometown or in your own district, but you really...
Do you want me to jump in and say something about it, Peggy?
Absolutely, Lucy. That would be great.
They have no clue that I do this. So, I mean, we
oh, good.
Really have not... There are only a couple students here, but we haven't really had an opportunity to meet, you know, online like this. So this is, you know, the first of hopefully many. So in addition, you know, I'm teaching this adjunct course for National Lewis. I went through this program myself like 10 years ago. And I wear a lot of hats as a consultant. And so with this guy, Steve Hargadon, that Peggy is mentioning, he and I have joined forces because we have an online community focused on connecting classrooms around the world and connecting classrooms to organizations that do interesting global work. And it's globaleducationconference.com. That's what you're looking at right now. And every November we do an online conference that's in webinar format. We don't use Zoom, but we use Blackboard Collaborate because we have a free license to it. I like Zoom better. So we're going to have to figure out a way to get Zoom to donate their services to us. And we probably get 200 to 300 sessions every year. And they're all recorded and archived. So we've got hundreds on our site, if not thousands at this point, that are archived. They're not, you can go in and look at them. You have to dig in a little bit. And maybe we'll do that for an activity in class one day. The other piece of this, too, is that Steve and I have been able to leverage our connections to bring in people who might not always be accessible to others. So, for instance, one of my favorite sessions was A friend of mine works for Brain Pop, and his dad happens to be Howard Gardner, who's a very famous professor at Harvard. And I had Andrew, this worked out really nicely, actually, because it wasn't a formal presentation. Andrew interviewed his dad. And I'm not sure if they've ever had that kind of, you know, interaction before like that. And it turned out to be a really lovely session. And my favorite part about it was somebody wrote in the evaluation of the session that they felt like they were up close and personal with Howard Gardner, and they normally would not ever be have an audience with somebody like that. And so they felt like they had a front row seat to all the action. And I think that's what the power of a lot of this learning is that you may live in the middle of nowhere or in another country that doesn't have a lot of PD going on or whatever your situation is, or you don't have time, or you have little kids at home, or whatever it is. And the technology allows you to keep on learning and have access to grow your professional learning network. That's the magic to me. So this is what I do. In addition to teaching a class for NLU and doing consulting work with schools and districts, this is my real passion. And I just thought I would jump in there because it's my thing. Oh.
Story that you shared.
I muted you instead of myself. Oh. Sorry. Keep going.
Am I now unmuted?
Yeah, you're unmuted now.
Okay. I'm so glad you shared that because I love that story about Andrew Gardner and Howie Gardner. That was a wonderful opportunity. And the point you make is so true. So often in webinars, you feel like you're right there in the room with the people that are presenting. And in addition, often there's a lot going on in a chat where people are sharing their own resources and links and ideas. And so you benefit not only from the presenters, but from the people in the room. And so that makes it great. Not all conferences are the same. The Global Ed Conference runs for a series of days in a row and for almost 24/7. The K-12 Online Conference is another one that I'm involved in, and it's done on demand. So while it happens at a certain time of year or day, the presentations are recorded and presented, so you can tune in anytime you want. You can also tune in on YouTube or iTunes U and watch the presentations there. This year we changed the format a little bit, and we have a keynote presentation followed by a panel discussion several days later, usually, about the keynote. And so it's not nearly as demanding on time as it used to be, but it's an excellent, excellent conference. And it's been around since the beginning too, Lucy. I think it started in 2006 or something like that. And some of these are actually courses. Electronic Village Online is an amazing program. They are all free courses, and within the courses you'll have webinars and presentations, but they're all organized around topics, and they usually go on at this time of year. I think most of them started at the beginning of January, and they run for 5 weeks. And that is an image there, so I can't scroll down and show you all of the different sessions, but they have one going on design thinking right now. They have one on, trying to think, Minecraft is one of them. So the topics are really interesting, and these are very informal classes. You don't have to start at the beginning and go through the end and do all the assignments that go with it. You can if you want to get a certificate for it, but you can also just go in and gather resources and learn from what's there and then curate those resources in the LiveBinder. So you'll have a way to save them and come back to them as you like. Some of them are one-day things like EdmodoCon, which is sponsored by Edmodo. This one's coming up in about a month. I'm very excited about this because they haven't always done one in Japan. I think this is the first time. Usually they're U.S.-centric. So this one is going to be February 25th. It's free to register. It will be a full day of presentations of teachers showing how they're using Edmodo and other digital tools for their professional development. And it's done in Japan. So that's an exciting thing. EduCon Philly is a face-to-face conference, but it also streams many of their sessions. This just occurred over the weekend. Some wonderful conversations, and their focus is conversations and not presentations. So not all of the sessions are streamed. And even some that are a little hard to follow because they'll break up into groups and have conversations. But sometimes they'll go in and out of their groups and then they'll share and they'll have documents to share and things like that. I just enjoyed this past weekend so much. And there were some really insightful educators who were really kind of stretching the thinking of the people in the room and those of us that were just participating virtually. So that gives you an idea of the types of virtual conferences there are that you can go to. Then I have this whole section in here that is all about some of the tools for growing your PLN and learning from other educators. And I'm so glad Lucy told you about Participate, because that is truly my favorite way to participate in Twitter chats and also to compile the resources from a Twitter chat. I work together with one of the founders of LiveBinders this past summer during ISTE. And together we curated an entire LiveBinder of all the resources from ISTE. And we called it Not at ISTE because there are lots of people that can't afford to go to that conference. And so we had so many people sharing with us, and every time they would share a resource that came from ISTE, we would add it to our collection, and I think the collection probably has over 2,000 resources in it. Sometimes there were Periscope recordings of presentations. Sometimes they were the actual recordings. Maybe it was an Ignite session or something like that. We also had our own Ignite sessions, and we had people who presented on Periscope for us in Not at ISTE, and all of those recordings and blog posts and things are in that LiveBinder. So that's also in my LiveBinder here, so you can check that out. Another thing I love to share with people that are doing professional development for others is this wonderful resource, which is a Flickr group for photos with quotes. Anyone can join, anyone can contribute, but you'll find a lot of great ideas that you can actually use in your presentations to spark conversations, things like that. I don't know if I can see, this is an image here, but there are thousands of images on this site. And all you have to do is go in and start scrolling, and you'll find quotes. People often will like go hear a keynote speaker, and they'll be really inspired by one of the ideas that's shared there. They'll take that, put that together with an image, and add it to this Flickr group. So I like to share that because I have been so inspired so many times by just going in and scrolling around and seeing what people are sharing and talking about. I also included some things in here, a lot of things related to hashtags and how they can help you grow your professional learning, because the hashtag is the heart of Twitter. if you follow a hashtag, you know that you're going to connect with other like-minded educators. So I have this link here that's all about hashtags, and the most famous link of all is Cyberman's site that not only lists tons of educational hashtags, but he also lists the Twitter education chat schedule on his site, and lots of resources about how you can find these groups and how you can actually use Twitter. He really has a whole page. Let's look at all these. He has a whole page. It's just on Twitter and how you can use that for your own professional learning. Then I'm going to skip over participate chat. I also have some resources in here about blogging. Sue Waters has done some amazing webinars over the years, and also blogging about blogging. And I put some of her best resources in here, because if you want to start blogging, or if you want to encourage your teachers to start blogging, this will get you started, and it will tell you all about how you can set up your blog and set up your pages, and how you can find people to connect with, how you work with images and copyright. Those are the kinds of things that she blogs about. She also has a whole student challenge and teacher challenge for blogging. So if you want, if you were a teacher and you wanted to set up blogging for your students, she has step-by-step instructions for how you can do that. I'm going to skip over some of those. Periscope is becoming a really easy way to share with other teachers. And once you start following some people on Periscope, you start getting notified of their sessions when they go live. And then you can watch them later if you're not available when they go live. But I have seen some really great presentations on Periscope, and I've also seen some that are not all that great. They're just sort of sitting and talking, and they don't have a lot to share. So you kind of have, as with all professional development, I think you have to make some judgments about what's worth your time. But I included a really excellent page on Periscope from Tony Vincent, and he did this awesome infographic that lets you know how to use it and what you can do with it, how you can find people to follow, how you can save your broadcast. So if you think that that might be something interesting to you, that would be a great page to check out. I also included some blogs here, and this teacher is one of the most incredible teachers I've ever seen. It is Hope King's blog. She calls it Elementary Shenanigans, and she teaches at the Ron Clark Academy. But I learned about that on Periscope, and she just happened to pop on. I just happened to click on it, and I can't tell you how impressed I was when I went to her website and saw what she was doing. Well, she did a classroom tour on Periscope, and the entire theme in her classroom was Alice in Wonderland. And if you want to be inspired by a teacher who just goes above and beyond to excite kids about learning, this only lasted for 3 days, but she's got videos of every phase in what she did. And she had parents volunteering to help her find things to decorate her room. This is her classroom. Isn't that amazing? I mean, who wouldn't be excited about learning in that environment? And it's not just play. I mean, there are learning objectives and standards and all kinds of things going on in that room. And the kids help with the setup of that environment. I love her Mad Hatter's chair for read-alouds. But you can see little videos of all of these things on her blog. So blogs are another great way. If you don't have time to tune into something at a set time, finding good people to follow who are blogging and sharing their teaching are a great way to go. So There are some other resources in this section that are just lesson resources. They might be lesson plans. LearnZillion has some great things. LessonCast has some great lessons. So I wanted to show that there are also other ways besides webinars and conferences that you can learn about some of these resources that either you can use.
Hey, can we stop for a second and take a few questions before Sylvia?
Yes. Oh, gosh. Our time is almost up. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm going to stop sharing.
Okay. So here's, I had a couple questions that I kept on writing down, but don't ask me what I did with them because we were very
chatty. Okay.
But here's one of the things. We were just talking about Periscope, and Kelly, who's one of the students in the class, said, why, she was bringing up the purpose of why would you want to do this? And I think, so the way I've seen people use it is for assessment purposes. Sometimes they broadcast the end product of a unit or something. Like, let's say you're doing a gallery walk of some artwork
yes.
that the kid did or
yes.
a performance or whatever. Here's the thing. I like it. I experiment with it when I'm taking my kids someplace. And I was at Brookfield Zoo, I don't know, a year or so ago, because it hasn't been out that long. And I actually had a really cool little tripod thing for my phone. And I was being so snazzy using Periscope. And I started getting, we were in the Gorilla House in the rainforest building there. And I got some really rude comments and really inappropriate stuff on there. And so
you have to be really careful.
Yeah. You have to be careful with it. And you have to think about whether your kids have policies, signed, whether your AUP is in your district, whether it's,
yes.
Whether there's an opt out thing, regardless, you probably don't want to do anything that connects your kid's name to an image of them.
Right.
Our
first names only.
Right. Yeah. And on Periscope, you can turn off the comments. So you
may, yes.
Or you can just invite certain people in. So maybe you could just invite your parents in or, something like that.
Yes. Those are all great points. And you definitely have to be aware of permissions and what your AEP says. Pass the Scope EDU has done some really wonderful things with teachers who prepare and come and share their students' work and ideas. I was just in one last weekend.
What's the name?
Pass the Scope EDU.
Yeah.
And it happened to be a teacher in Arizona that I follow who teaches fifth grade. And he went from station to station in his classroom and had students explain the design thinking that they were doing in their projects and to show the projects they created. So it was sort of like a show and tell, but it was a very controlled kind of thing. But you definitely have to be aware of permissions, and you have to be aware of what, like you said about the zoo, what you're actually capturing, and if there are inappropriate things on there. You can always delete them, but they are live at the time, so you just want to be careful.
If you're not comfortable with it, and you have to be able to
yes.
act nimbly. So my last question for you, and if anybody else has questions, type them in the chat. My last question for you is, if for these students who are going to be designing an online professional development experience, and I'm not really sure, I have to look at the actual description of the benchmark project.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the intent, I think the intent was it was supposed to be like a set of web pages. But we don't have to stick to that. I think we can be pretty creative with it. What are some things that you would keep in mind if you were designing an online professional development event of some sort? What are some tips?
Gee, the events vary so much. So it really depends on if you're doing a face-to-face event. That can also be online. There's so many variations, but you're thinking that their project is going to be an online PD event.
Yeah. And the idea is that they're going to kind of like see what the possibilities are, in these conversations that we're having.
Yes.
Going to address something that to their particular situation. So for instance, Irene works with, she operates a business that provides cultural experiences for kids in schools. So she may want to do something for the teachers ahead of time,
you know, yes,
to prep them for it, or she may want to design some sort of experience for the people that work for her doing the training or doing the, you know, leading these experiences.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I want something to be really practical that people can take back and use in their settings. So for example,
yes,
maybe it'll be something that she could use with her team. Like maybe she works with other grade level teachers and she could go back and lead something with them. Or, you know, we have an eighth grade math teacher in our group who I don't think is here right now. You know, that kind of thing. So I'm just wondering,
yes,
we've talked about the characteristics of adult learning. We've talked about tech integration models. We were talking this week a little bit about change and how that happens and whether technology can facilitate change in situations. I thought we'd end here with like a few little tips about, you know, what they could think about.
Okay. Well, I know that some of the most effective online experiences are based in a learning management system so that you have ways to kind of roll things out, you know, over time and focused in specific ways. I'm sure that's what you're doing with your course.
Yeah.
And I know also that you need to keep those presentations short. You know, an hour-long webinar is almost too much for a teacher. yeah, I know. And most of the webinars I go to are that long. They're between 30 and 60 minutes. But when it's in a professional development learning experience, I think if you can keep them 5 to 20 minutes, you're much better off, and then have the conversation around them. Just like with flipped learning, you know, you're going to give them some content, but then the real meat of it is to do something with it. Have a conversation, apply some of what you've heard about, and then come back and share it, that kind of thing.
Yeah, teachers don't have enough time to explore things, and as Kelly's pointing out, so that's great.
Right, and so that's where something like a live binder comes in, or a participate collection, where you can curate some resources that are the cream of the crop for them, and share them with them so that you know that they're getting some good content, but they don't have to spend hours and hours doing Google searches for things that they have no idea whether they're going to be useful or not. And that can be good backup or supplemental to whatever you're doing in the actual presentation. But the more engaged you can get them actively involved, just like at Ed Camps, you know, where everyone is an expert in the room. You all have something to share. And I think that sort of attitude about all professional development is really important. And you want to set it up in such a way that they all feel valued and encouraged to share in whatever ways they can. Those are just some of the things I would say.
Okay.
And don't use the fire hose approach like I did tonight. But encourage them to start slow.
I tend to be a fire hoser, so yeah.
Well, I'm one of those people that gets so excited about the things I'm talking about, and good thing you stopped me, or I could have gone on and on, but you don't want to bowl people over with your over-enthusiasm, but you certainly do want to share your passion and encourage them to explore their own passions.
Awesome. That's a perfect way to end. Peggy, awesome. Thank you very much. If I could make myself show up again in it with video, I would. When I mouse over my window, I just get, it's hard to get the video icon. I can only rename my thing.
Can you get it from the menu?
No, I don't think, maybe if I pop it out, I can do it better. No, it pops, you know what it does? It pops out, the rename button overrides the video button.
Oh.
And then I hid myself kind of, wait, no.
I have a stop video at the bottom of my screen.
Yeah, I don't want to stop it because it's going to be one continuous recording.
Right. Well, that's not recording, that's stop video.
Oh, so maybe it's, there. So now.
Yeah, now you're up. Yeah, now your video's on.
You can see me? You can see me now?
Ooh. Yeah.
Okay, there we go.
Well, you've gone back to your icon.
Okay. We saw you before.
Yeah.
That's fine. Okay.
And now you can't see me.
Do it again. One more time.
There we go.
There you are.
Oh,
all right.
I'm sewing the whole time. So you're seeing me like multitask and everything. All right. Peggy, stick around if you want to. And there's Kelly. Hi, Kelly. Yay. And you guys can all obviously mute and unmute you if, yourselves if you want to. So we have Kelly, who's one of my students this quarter. Hi. Kelly, do you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Kelly Funk. I'm in Prospect Heights, Illinois for teaching. I live in McHenry, Illinois, so more north.
What grade are you, third or fourth grade?
Fourth grade.
Okay.
Yeah, I teach fourth grade bilingual, literacy, and gen ed, all other subjects.
Okay, so you're going to really like Sylvia because Sylvia is bilingual. She's probably trilingual, actually. She's amazing. And then we have Russ, who is in Hyde Park, I think, and he's another TIE instructor. He's taught in the program, and I've known him for a number of years, so he's just hanging out here. Irene is one of our students, and I don't know who Van DR is. Van DR has been very quiet. Maybe Van, I don't know who that is. And then we have Sylvia. Oh, wait, we have somebody popping up. Oh, it's you, Vicky. It's you. I'm like, who's Van DR? It's Vicky Andrews.
It just came up as part of it.
Ah, okay. And she's in Arizona too, Peggy. But you should get, I think, have you guys met before, Vicky and Peggy?
No, we haven't. I'm up in Payson, Peggy. So I'm a good clip north of you.
And Vicky used to teach at, she used to be the tech coordinator at Northside College Prep here in Chicago, which is one of the best CPS schools. And she's going to do one of these sessions with us one of these days. So she's just dropping in tonight. I'm going to introduce you really, guys, quickly so we can get to Sylvia. Sylvia has been Languages, like Witches, is how you can follow her on Twitter. And she's one of these people since, again, I met her probably about the time I met Peggy, back when we all started blogging and tweeting and getting connected, and she's been phenomenal, a phenomenal, phenomenal presence with sharing her work. You have to check out her blog and her website. I have not, Sylvia, I have not seen you or heard from you in a long time. I know that you, last I heard, so she's also done a lot of work with, I'm blanking on her name, famous ASCD person. Who am I thinking of, Sylvia?
Heidi Hayes Jacobs.
Hi, Hayes Jacobs. So she's had tons of experiences. She used to teach in Florida. She was in Brazil. I don't know where you are now, Sylvia. Where are you?
Wherever you want me to be. I'm in Florida tonight.
Oh, good, 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 good. And So Sylvia, I don't know if you heard what we're doing, but this course is on staff development. I'm trying to give some people in my class some inspiration. A lot of the people will be watching this after the fact. But like, what are some of the opportunities out there? Whatever you want to talk about, we're happy to hear. But we're so excited to have your expertise here. So thank you for coming, and I'll turn it over to you.
Okay, sounds good. Well, when I first saw your Facebook call, said anybody brave enough? I said, I think I'll be brave. But it's one of those things, and I think maybe, you know, for your students to hear that too, it's because what you put into your learning and into your network, this is what will come out. So Lucy, I have known her since, like, you know, forever, which in Twitter or blogging years is about 10 years. And Lucy has helped me out and has done things, you know, called in for me, and all the work that she has done for so many people for so many years now, it's time to give back, and it's a give and take. And that's kind of how I feel. And that's why I said, yeah, you know, I'm staying up past my bedtime here in Florida and do some central time chatting with you guys. But you know, when you said you can talk about anything, it's about professional development. Right now, I'm what do you say in English? Knee deep? Well, I'm not knee deep. I'm neck deep into writing a book. And I'm writing a book together with Janet Hale, which she's also ASCD and with Heidi Hayes Jacobs, about one of my passions, which is documenting learning. And it goes, you know, when you hear documenting learning, everybody says, oh yeah, I do that all the time. I write down my lesson plans and then I look over the lesson plans and I rewrite the lesson plans. But a lot of times that's really the only documenting that we as educators are doing. And a lot of student learners are, the only documentation they're doing are their weekly quizzes or their tests or their final projects. And that's the only documenting of their learning that exists. So my whole idea was, I know from blogging now for so long, I've been documenting my journey. Happens most of the time, I look for a subject, I Google, and I find my own blog. So it's become my hub for my learning journey of 2007, when I'm trying to think, how will I use blogs in my Spanish classroom? And now 10 years later, where have I been? What were my breadcrumbs? Where have I gone? Because I have blogged and I've documented and shared my learning, all of this is kind of accessible. So the whole idea of documenting learning that I'm trying to articulate and then be able to share in this book is not just documenting of learning, but how do we get document for learning? And then even one step further, when does documentation become the learning? Documentation as learning. So that's right now, documenting learning. How do we capture it? How do we look for it? How do we capture it? How do we reflect on learning through documentation? And how do we then share the learning? And how do we amplify learning through documentation? So that's kind of right now where I'm neck deep into it and I want to share with you. And I think I can maybe piggyback on where Peggy left off. The last question that you had asked, Lucy, was how can your students use this for their capstone project or as professional development for their own in their classrooms or with other teachers that they teach? And I want to throw into that mix as one strategy, what if you were to document your own learning of this course with the very intentional and strategic goal that others will learn from you? So your goal is to document your own learning path, knowing you will have an audience who will want to learn from you. So that's kind of the idea where I would suggest as a strategy that what you could do. And the interesting part as I was digging deeper and deeper into this whole notion of documenting of for as learning is the idea, this is not just for students. Kindergarten kids, high school kids, university students. This is an entire strategy and framework for learning, or for as learning, for learners, no matter what age, to teachers who are documenting the learning of their students, then teachers documenting their own learning, and then as a fourth layer, schools documenting the learning that is going on in their schools as institutional memory. So that's the idea. I'm going to share my screen if that is okay with you guys. There we go. And just give me a thumbs up real quick if you can see my screen. Okay, thank you. And again, this is not this kind of thinking or professional development or whatever you want to call it. This is not an add-on. This is not a new initiative to start. This is how we learn, and this is how we can also strategy for teaching. So it is simply about learning. There's nothing else. There's no other reason. There's no other goal. This is for learning. And that kind of took me to the idea of looking at, you know, we all talk about pedagogy, right? Pedagogy, strategies, techniques, methods that teachers use to facilitate learning in students. And pedagogy is you focus in on the student, student-centered. I'm sorry, this is teacher-centered, looking at the student though, because we're facilitating the learning for them. But then I came across, and I'm admitting it, I had no idea, not even how to pronounce that that gogy thing. So I decided in the end, I'm going to call it udagogy. And always willing, anybody wants to tell me I have to pronounce this differently, but udagogy is the science of self-directed and self-determined learning, self-motivated learning. And that's where I really got excited, because I was like, oh, this is where we can dig deeper into that, because that is no longer for, it's not about the teacher and what they have to do. It's the student, self-motivated, self-directed learning by the learner, by the student. So from looking at that, learning how to learn and looking at these two, the pedagogy and the udagogy, I went to, you know, to really figure out, how does documenting play a role into making, letting it happen and just observing it and being aware of it, the metacognition of thinking about your thinking, about how am I learning this or why am I learning this and what are my next steps? This kind of thinking, this is what I thought. It's like, if we can get learners to spend more time of reflecting and thinking about their thinking, we've got something here. And I did some research, obviously, you know, so let's see how documentation and pedagogy, let's see what I can find. And I found amazing work, pedagogical documentation, it is called. And the pedagogical documentation, all I found was early learning. Reggio Emilia, if you've heard of that method, they have extensively looked at and are using pedagogical documentation. Documentation as a strategy to facilitate learning. And the more I went and dug into that, the more I realized they are not using technology whatsoever, very Montessori type as well. So, excuse me, no technology. And because there's not technology for technology's sake, but no technology to be able to share what they're doing with a wider audience. The sharing that they are advocating is sharing between colleagues, the teachers in the same school, sharing with other kids within the same school, kindergarten kids sharing with fourth grade students from their school. But that was limited, maybe sharing with parents to talk about the learning of their children with the teacher. And to me, I said, like, again, this is something we can amplify. Well, if we're using technology to document, we are able to amplify, and then it just doesn't become focused in on the teacher and one particular student, but it's when it becomes shareable, we can go global. We can share best practices. We can share, this worked for us. We can help you not having to reinvent the wheel. We can give you resources, information. I mean, really good stuff. So from there, I said, well, if there is pedagogical documentation, let me look and see what are we doing here with udagogical documentation. And didn't exist. I could not find anything where people are using documentation as a strategy to move and facilitate self-directed, self-motivated learning. And so that is kind of is shaping my book of figuring out how can I use documentation to document my own learning to help me. And this goes very well. I don't know if you've, have you heard of the term webucation? If you Google that webucation, you will find, especially on YouTube and other video sites, you will find when learners go to the web to get their own education. You will find videos of people who said, I want to learn how to dance in a certain way. And they're learning it purely by watching videos of other dancers who have documented their strategies for learning the dancing and have documented and then shared it. If you want to learn how to play the guitar, same thing. People are self-motivated and are becoming self-directed in learning. We don't have to go to a school anymore. We don't have to go to a workshop. We don't have to wait for the next conference to be offered. It's there. So for me, that documentation is a visible, interconnected, metacognitive approach for creating evidence of one's learning. That's kind of the essence of how I decided to frame it. And I already had shared with you, I see these four different layers where student is the primary learner and they are documenting their own learning. Teacher is the primary learner and they're either documenting student learning or their own learning. And then schools as a whole are documenting what are they doing? What are their initiatives? How can you document? Is it going anywhere? Is it actually successful? Or are we just spinning our wheels? So I don't know if this kind of helps a little bit as well, just breaking it down. Documenting of learning is, I see that as documenting what was done. What did you do? Take a picture of it. That's a documentation of the learning that happened. They're snapshots. And usually they are shared to just display, hey guys, look what we did. And if you go on Twitter and you just look at the last 10 pictures, teachers or anyone shared about their classroom, they all usually fall in that category. Documentation of learning. Look, 10 kids playing on the iPad. It really doesn't give me evidence that learning is going on, but it's documentation of learning. The second piece, documentation for learning, is when we go to a different layer, is when we're trying to make not just what was done, but the thinking that was invisible. How do we make that visible? And I think Peggy mentioned somebody that she watched a Periscope where they somebody filmed the kids who are articulating, not just showing the camera, look, here's our project, this is our final display, but they are articulating what had they learned, what is this about, and they're sharing their thinking. It's a way, it's interpreting the artifact that was captured that is supposed to be evidence of the learning. And then we go to documentation as learning, when the learning becomes visible. And that happens usually not just a one-time thing, but it happens over time. It happens over time that when you have blogged, not just 3 or 4 blog posts, but you're already thinking, I'm going to write a blog post. How will I document this? I was like, these are the important objectives that I need to have evidence of in order to paint a really good picture of how my learning looked like. Does that make sense? Let me stop here for a second. And I'm not looking at the chat, so I don't know if
Peggy. I'm really excited about this stuff. And I have a friend who is a teaches at a Reggio school in Wisconsin. She's the head of lower school. And I just sent her the link and said, come join us. You'd love this conversation. She's from Brazil too, by the way, Sylvia. So double bonus there. But I guess what I'm thinking about is this is such a thoughtful, intellectual approach to how we view teaching and learning in general, what you're espousing. And I see a lot of teachers who are overwhelmed right now with so much to do and so many mandates to follow. And even like teaching my little online course, I have so much stuff that gets in the way of actually designing an interesting course, frankly. So how do we get teachers to be this thoughtful and give them time to do it? And maybe I'm jumping ahead here. And that sort of thing, in order to kind of foster a culture that values this sort of thing. And then I'll say one, which makes me think of Tim Lauer, who another person who we all started out with in EdTech. And he, when he was a principal, he would put, he would allow time for the teachers to blog during faculty meetings. So that was their, and that was like their newsletter basically. It wasn't as deep as this kind of thing, but he built the time in, and I think that's part of the answer. But I'm just curious, you know, maybe you'll get to it eventually, but that's what's on my mind listening to you.
Well, I'll probably get to it tomorrow, you know, probably not in the next half an hour, but you're absolutely right. Main thing to remember is this is not all you do. One of those things, you heard it somewhere, it's that, I have no idea where it came from. I heard about the turtle approach. So the turtle approach is you start out with one thing you try to work through. And again, there is a learning curve how does it feel like to do documentation of learning? How does it feel like doing documentation for learning? And once it becomes, when it is as learning, that's when it's not in addition to, this is how you do it. When you're researching, curating, reading, discarding, tagging, that becomes the learning. So it's a way of finding. You will have to invest time to get started, to get over that learning curve, but then it will give you that time back because students are going to document their own learning. They will reflect on their learning, they will share their learning, you will do the same thing, you will share with colleagues, they will give back to you. So
it's an investment of time up front, but then once you have the processes in place, everything kind of becomes more smooth.
As I said, Luz, it's not that you suddenly, this doesn't replace anything, it's the way how you do it. So you're still doing the same things that you're doing, but instead of, for example, of creating a test to check if your kids did the 10 spelling words correctly, you will have them write a blog post to see if they can use those spelling words.
Yeah, that's brilliant. And that's what we want people to get in general, I think.
Right.
So I want to introduce Adriana Hollenbeck, who is up in Wisconsin at a private school that is Reggio-based in the lower school, and she's the lower school head, and she's from Brazil. And Sylvia, are you from Brazil originally? You're Brazilian and German, aren't you?
No, Argentinian.
Argentinian.
But I lived in São Paulo for a year.
Okay. Okay. So that's close enough. So there's a little bit of kinship here. So Adriana, if you wanted to say hi and tell us how you guys, can you just tell us for like 2 seconds how Reggio works in your school and your approach in the lower school?
Well, the lower school is K-3 through 4th grade. When I started working at University Lake School, again, it's a private independent school here in Wisconsin, I came as a parent because I fell in love with the Reggio approach. We were looking for the right place for my only child, and Nicholas was supposed to go to all the other schools, like everybody else in the family, and we were looking for something different, and I learned that ULS was Reggio-inspired. And I fell in love with it. I started researching it. And then when I enrolled Nicholas, I brought my resume and I talked to the headmaster. I said, I'm going to bring my child every morning and I'm going to leave. And you don't want me to leave. You want me to stay here because I believe in this. This is how it should be done. So anyway, 2 years later, he hired me as a media specialist. And now I'm the lower school head. We were doing the Reggio Inspiration was just restricted to pre-primary. And when I became the lower school head, I moved some teachers around and I said, we need to spread the wealth because there was a line separating kindergarten from the other grades. So I think this is where we are right now, is finding that balance. We just watched Most Likely to Succeed last week, and you know, everybody came back like, poof, oh my gosh. Because I mean, I think the principles we can apply them to, you know, all the grades. The kids, it's not just for pre-primary or the lower grades. There's so much in it. We are student-led, we are project-based, but sometimes we get a little pushback. The community, you know, it's traditional Lake Country, Wisconsin, they're talking about test scores and all those things that you guys will know so well. Are they going to learn how to spell? I mean, can they do math? Will they learn their math facts if they, you know, choose what they want to study? So those are all questions that, you know, everybody has been asking. And sometimes the teacher's like, you know, this whole Reggio thing. So we talk a lot about it. It's not easy. It really isn't.
So what we're talking about tonight with Sylvia. Sylvia's worked with independent and international schools and Heidi Hayes Jacobs, and she's writing a book on documenting learning in a variety of forms, I guess, is how I would put it. And so we're kind of midway through it, and I was just thinking of you and thought I'd invite you in here because I thought you'd enjoy this conversation. And we're all kind of chatting in the text chat while Sylvia is adding her two cents. So I just thought, I'm glad you can be here with us and join our little community tonight.
Thank you. Yeah.
So as Lucy said, you know, it's very high thinking and everything. Let me share with you maybe some more concrete examples. Meet Elena. Elena is my granddaughter, and she learned, is in the process still of learning how to swim. So I thought I would document her learning how to swim. And starting out with just taking photos. Hey, there she's in the pool with her little floaties on. And these images, those are just capture evidence of learning. This is where she is in this moment in time. And when I took, I got an underwater camera, and I documented for learning, taking these pictures and then annotating the images. It's like, what does that mean in terms of her skills? I already had thought about what are some of the skills that I want, you know, that I know breaking down. How do you learn how to swim? So one of them is to make sure that she learns how to not swim like this, but to have her hands together. Now, the reason why I took these images is for Elena, so she can use them, the documentation, for her learning, to think about like, I need to put my hands together. When we get home from the pool, she's immediately like, can we look at the videos? Can we look at the pictures? And now she's using those artifacts for her own learning, to see what otherwise she was not able to see. She could not, you know, she can't see herself. She had the floaties on. She can't make that connection yet to be able to think, am I working on my skills? Does that make sense? Does that help a little bit with the images? So when you look at the images and you're moving from four learning to as learning, is when we're making the learning visible, not just the thinking, but the learning. I'm breaking down the different skills, keeping her hands close to be able to the floating part, confidence in not being afraid of the water, to then showing the growth. of on the left over here, still with her hands open, to on the way on the right, you can see how her hands are already closed. And then she finally actually is going underwater. So that's kind of showing the difference of learning, just taking pictures. Look, this is where she is this moment in time for learning. When I'm using the images to help her grasp the concepts of where she is, what she still has to work on. And then as learning, when we are taking the images and we are interpreting the images, we're interpreting the artifacts, what does that mean in terms of learning? Has she shown growth over time? So that's kind of individual skills, kicking and pushing of the wall, and just adding more artifacts to show that she is learning, and that she, what she still needs to work on in that sense. Any questions regarding the images or the difference between of, for, and as learning?
I think we're okay.
Okay. So, and then of course, here's my very favorite picture of her finally first time underwater, which was a big success, which again, for her to be able to see it, to able to replay that moment when she succeeded was for the four-year-old super, super important. In the process of the whole idea of the documentation, I created this workflow of when you get started, you need to look for learning. And the looking part is, you know, you think might be the easiest one, but so many teachers have difficulty within even a school. What is evidence of learning? How can I look for something that I don't even know how to recognize? So if you're in your school, you have a teacher that thinks that evidence of learning is a picture of a quiz of spelling words and the student got a 10 out of 10, that's evidence of learning. And another teacher, as I mentioned before, has the students write a blog post and can see if the students can use those words. There's a disconnect of within your school, what is evidence of learning? And that common vocabulary needs to be just talked about. It needs to be part of the conversation of when you're asking your teachers, your learners to look for learning. The same thing goes with, do students know what learning looks like in themselves, in others? Second stage of the workflow is capturing learning. How do we capture learning? Is it best to capture learning with text, writing, a narrative? Is it best to capture learning with an image? Is it best to capture learning with a video or maybe just an audio that might, if you talked a little earlier, I heard you guys mention privacy of what are you allowed to tape with your students. So having some type of fluency in different media to be able to capture the learning, to be able to edit the learning, to be able to format the learning. And then, super important, the reflecting piece. If you're familiar with, let's see, where is it? One of my favorite books, which I'm sure Adriana is very familiar with, Visible Learners. And they said any documentation that does not have the interpreting of the documentation is just display. And wholeheartedly agree. We have to figure out, the learner has to know what to do with the documentation, with the captured artifacts. So many teachers, they take 1,000 pictures, 100 hours of video, and then nothing ever gets done with it. So learning how to look at the artifacts, reflecting on it, connecting them, putting them in hierarchy of importance, looking for patterns or trends. What does this mean? What does this mean in terms of Where did I come from? Where am I going? How will this inform what I need to learn next or what I need to teach next? Those are all pieces that that cannot be seen as an add-on. And again, Lucy, you said, how do we do this when we already have enough to do? I can't stress enough, reflection should never, ever be the one that gets tossed out when you don't have any more time to do something. That's the essence of learning. So then from look, capture, reflect, we go to the share piece. And again, this is where I move away from Reggio, as I mentioned before, Adriana joined us, is what does sharing mean? Sharing just mean within the class, within your classroom walls? Does it mean I'm sharing with another colleague who's down the hallway? Does it mean I'm sharing with a different grade level? Does it mean I'm sharing with the parent community? Or does it mean I'm sharing with a global audience? I'm sharing at conferences. I'm sharing through my blog. I'm having the learner share. And because of the degrees of sharing, that's when amplification happens. That's when amplifying your learning happens, because suddenly you're sharing your learning about your own teaching, and somebody in Australia reads your blog post, leaves you a comment saying, I'm doing this as well. Take a look at what I'm finding. Take a look at my documentation of my students or my own documentation of learning. And it will propel you further, because now you've made a connection. Now you've amplified what you couldn't have done by yourself. So look, capture, reflect, share, and amplify is really, that's the workflow. And just as when you're learning how to ride a bike or you're learning how to drive a car, it's like, oh my gosh, what do I have to do first? And then I have to go into, you know, if you're learning to drive stick, little more steps too. But in the end, it will all become fluent as you're speaking another language as well. It might be so much to remember in the beginning, but the more you practice it, you will become fluent at it. I'm going to stop here again just to see if there are any questions, any ideas, thoughts.
I think we're good.
All good?
Yeah.
I left you speechless? Oh, we're getting too late in Central Time as well.
Oh, the book that you showed.
Visible Learners by Krzyzewski, Mardell, Rivard, and Wilson.
Okay, I was looking at the wrong one. Oh, wait, no. I think this is it. I think I do have the right one.
Okay. I can't. This is a fantastic book, which is also, you know, as I said, Reggio and Emilia, mostly when I did the research, it was mostly for early learning. This book takes it, this is not just for early learning, it's this K-12. And my book will take it further. It's like, this is not just for early learning, this is not just for K-12. This is for any learner at any age, including post-grad. So I guess we're amplifying as we're stepping on each one of those different pieces as well.
I think, is Visible Learning a big part of the Project Zero stuff in the summer too?
Visible Thinking. Is what Project Zero is about. Okay. And visible thinking takes on, in my mind, a big component. If you want to document in order to share, you have to make it visible. You have to figure out how to make it visible. Otherwise, it's just going to stay in your head, or you're going to talk about it, which then your words and your conversation will disappear. So you have to find a way to capture it. And to be able to share it then, once you captured it, it has to be visible.
Go together. Okay, got it.
Yes. So let me skip ahead over here. So how do you do that? Just to take a look at the tools, at the technology tools, which again, that's what distinguishes, I guess, a little bit from regular Amelia, is we're using technology, not for the technology's sake, but with the goal to be able to share and amplify beyond the classroom walls in your building. So through images, audio, blogs, back channel tools, video, screencasting, screenshots, and sketchnotes. Those are the ones that I pretty much move in and out of, and I have become quite fluent to be able to document learning. For a blog, and those are just suggestions. Obviously, there are thousands of tools out there. Every day, there's more tools coming. It doesn't really matter to me what tool you're using to do this. This is just to get you started, to have some idea. WordPress as a blogging platform, which Peggy mentioned, Sue Waters from EduBlogs, which is fantastic. I believe KidBlogs is also based on WordPress. I have not used it. And the other thing, as so many of the schools, I gave schools Google Apps for Education schools, Blogger is another option that you can use as a hub for writing and at the same time share any documentation in any medium. So text, images, audio, video can all be embedded, and it becomes this beautiful chronological order, taggable, categorizable, labelable, whatever it is, that will help you with documentation. Going to images, here are some of my favorite ones that I use to annotate images, to add another layer of text to an image to make thinking, learning visible to somebody else or to myself as well. Specifically, if I want to point a learning objective or a specific skill that I'm looking for, that I want to be documenting to show growth over time, or even the absence of that skill, to be able to share with others. Notability is a great app to be able to annotate, highlight. Word Swag, Typorama, Picolage, Halftone, Comic Life, and then paper as well. Paper has some great updates that allows you to annotate over every any image. Moving on to video, Snapchat. Snapchat is some, it's crazy. I really resisted for a long time to try this. And I'm in love suddenly with book snaps, which is fantastic documentation of what you're reading and what you're thinking, and your little sticky notes that we used to put into. I have so many books that have my hundreds of sticky notes on there. You can directly do digitally now and share that. Movie Maker, iMovie, Periscope, Vine, all different types of being able to document with video of evidence of learning. Whoops, so sorry. Let's get that back. Then we have sketchnotes, and I don't know if you have ventured out into the world of sketchnoting. It is a visual form of note-taking that is taking learners, education, business, everybody by storm. It's a way of thinking. And then using a different part of your brain, and with fantastic results. And sketchnotes, if you're looking at a sketchnote made by another sketchnoter, you actually are able to look at by analyzing their typography, by analyzing what types of metaphors did they use to represent a concept, by looking at their connectors between the different concepts, what they're thinking. So it is a fantastic way of making thinking and learning visible. Audio, GarageBand, audio memo, Audacity, lots of different ones. iPhone, I think, has its own audio memo, I think it's called. It's on every smartphone, or should be on every smartphone. Screencasting and screen shooting, as I call it. Lots of different apps that that allow you to do that on your smartphone, on your tablet, or your desktop. But essentially, it records your screen as you're able to record your voice and record your mouse movement or your hand movement if you're on the tablet, and gives a fantastic way for a learner to explain their thinking and just sharing what they're seeing on their screen and why this is an important piece of their learning process. Then a back channel. If you're not familiar with a back channel, right now, if you are in the chat of this webinar, you are participating in a back channel. I'm talking in the front here, and then there's another conversation, and I just saw it pop up again, 123 messages. So that's a back channel, which I have used as a really in-depth way of documenting a conversation. Today's Meet is a platform, very, very nice and clean, and I've used it, third graders and up, very successfully. Of students simply typing in what they're thinking, answering questions that were posed, talking to each other as they're listening to, watching a movie or listening to a conversation, a Skype call, a webinar, whatever it is. By the end, you have all this log of a documentation of what was talked about. Again, that's not all what a back channel does to give you that copy. It's about, what are you doing now with that artifact? Are you going through it with your students? Are you unpacking it? What does that mean? Who spoke? Who helped somebody else? Who asked questions? Who answered questions? There's so many ways of unpacking a back channel for learning. And then using it to decide, well, what am I going to learn next, or what will I teach next? The same thing, it could be done with a Google Doc, where all your students are sharing a Google document, and everybody has a space where they can add their notes. Twitter is also being used as a back channel tool, usually with a hashtag, and Peggy shared with you hashtags. The conversation is connected through the hashtag, which then you can use as a back channel that you can pull out and unpack and see who contributed. What does that mean? Did somebody else learn from that contribution? Did it change your mind? Did you use it to find a new resource that you wouldn't have found otherwise? Lots of different ways of being able to use a back channel. And I think those are all the tools that I had here to share with you. And we're getting close, and I do want to leave some time for for any questions. Let me stop sharing. There we are.
That was fabulous. I mean, there's some things that you've said and other people have been sharing that I haven't heard of before. So this has been fabulous. But I think most importantly for me, the processes and thinking about documenting your learning and reflecting on it, I think that's been the big takeaway for me. And like, how can we, in our final projects for this course, how can we make sure that we embed elements with that? I've talked enough, so I'm going to ask people, grab the video cam or your microphone. You can unmute yourself and ask a question if anybody wants to, because I've talked enough. Or add a comment. Anybody feedback for Silvia on this? As she produces this book, is there anything that she needs to add or really emphasize or take into account?
I liked it.
You liked it?
Yeah, I thought it was really good. I love those resources. I kind of collect those too. So I think those are great. I like that you talk about the different ways for teachers to use them and students to use them. So I think that's really good because they can be used for us as teachers as well as students. And I think that gets forgotten a lot of the time. You know, a lot of the time we just focus on the kids because that's what we're doing it for. But knowing that we're using it professionally for us is a good thing too. So that was great.
So Kelly, are you documenting any, I mean, you're starting out with all this stuff. You're like me, you know, 8 years ago, I was still in the classroom. I got excited about all this stuff. I started jumping into it. That's the vibe I'm getting from you so far. And like, so how are you documenting your own learning as, especially because you're towards the end of this technology and education program. So, you know, I don't know, you know, how that drives with everything, but you know, what have your experiences been the last couple of years?
Well, professionally, I try and document like what I'm doing to make myself a better learner in general. So I actually went to a workshop. It was in, I think it was like a de-ice conference, and they had like a professional development where you're able to like take your portfolio and put it on a Google site. So I've been creating and documenting things that I've been doing for myself to kind of remember all the things you do, because I feel like you never remember all the things you're doing throughout a whole year that you've been doing. And personally, I forget a lot of stuff, even like, you know, like you said, the whole fountain thing or whatever, fire hose thing. It can be a little much at times. So just trying to remember some of the things that you're using and going through.
That's why I started blogging back in the day, which I don't do as much anymore, but it was to remember things. And then it kind of took it. I think there's a progression, Sylvia, of like how people go through all this stuff. So I started documenting myself in Blogger. One of the first things I wrote was, there's a really great park where I used to live on Margate Terrace in between Lawrence and Wilson off Lakeshore Drive. And it have actually, after we moved out of this neighborhood, they built this park, and you would go to it, and it was just artistically just gorgeous and landscaped, and you'd see every person from around the globe, you know, kind of person represented in this park, and it was what you imagine ideal society should be like, right? And so I took pictures of it and wrote about it. I didn't think anybody would ever look at it, and the landscape design firm found it and said, can we use some of your pictures and your and quote you in our brochure or something? And so, you know, it was, I the idea of writing for a public audience, like anybody, I didn't think anybody cared about what I had to say about anything. So that's another element of this too, is like, you never know about the serendipitous connections that can come from documenting your own learning. I think that's been a big thing for me personally.
That's that amplification part.
Yeah,
it's when, you know, once you share, it amplifies that you had no idea. I have Irene. Irene said, I used to love to write until I started to blog. And I would see if you can maybe elaborate a little bit on that, Irene. Am I picking on you? I'm sorry.
No, she's saying it's a chore. It was a chore.
I agree with her.
You know what? Then there's something, then you need to take a step back. It's not supposed to be a chore.
Do you think it's, so Kelly, maybe have you guys been required to blog incessantly throughout the technology and education program?
Yeah.
So it hasn't been fun. And like the discussion forums, like, you know, are not really conducive to.
Yeah. Writing. I think it's not really applied directly to you. You know, I think it's more applied to like a general statement, kind of like if you give the kids a certain topic to write about, some kids will be okay with that. Some kids won't be okay with that. You know, so it's really like your interest level in that topic and if that's something you're really passionate about. Because like currently, like what I'm passionate about is I like sketchnoting. So I'm kind of into that right now. I'm kind of like focusing on that. And then I'm also kind of into like formative assessments, trying to figure out a gradeless semi-approach in my grade kind of driven class.
Does that sound at all like self-directed and self-motivated learning to you?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it does.
It is.
You know, school
is built for this.
Yeah, because schooling isn't really like that now. And that's sometimes what I have a struggle with in higher education in general, is because I feel like you're still in that box of certain things, but we're not really taught that way to teach that way. So in my mind, I go, like, how can I be a part of that? And it's almost like you have to just conform, because that's the way the situation is. And I totally get it. I'll do what I need to do. But I, you know.
It's checkbox learning. So as I go through this course, which, you know, Kelly, I don't know, you weren't here at the beginning when I was talking about it, but I'm using an existing shell that was developed a couple of years ago, and I'm supposed to kind of rewrite things as we go, and I'm finding it to be tedious to do. I mean, it's, and so I'm trying to adapt things so it's more interesting, more engaging, and more personalized. But but the other piece is too, with college programs like this too, you also have to use something like live text for documenting your stuff, right? I mean, that's your portfolio system, which they started after I graduated from this particular program. We could make it, when we did our portfolios, we could use whatever we wanted to do. And I did something that allowed me to create a PDF so I was able to give it to, you know, people who wanted to hire me pretty easily. That seemed to be the best platform then. But yeah, it's not practicing what we preach, and the technology actually, I feel like in the course software, and sorry, Angela, if you watch this later on, who's the person that is my supervisor, it doesn't lend itself to any fluidity, or it's checkbox learning. And, and so I think there's an art to how do we incorporate this thoughtful kind of approach to our own learning into this kind of factory model that a lot of colleges of education are still adhering to.
Yeah. I think that's what's hard for like elementary, you know, and high school and stuff. You're seeing what they're still going to. So you also feel like they're at a disadvantage when they get there because they haven't had those kind of experiences. So it's like teaching to the test. Like, are you really going to not give them that experience? But are you really, you know what's better, but you also want them to be successful in the future in these kind of boxed experiences. I don't know. It's like a given.
I think high school teachers are the hardest to, and I know Silvia worked with high school teachers at Graded, right, Silvia?
Yes.
They're the toughest nuts to crack because it's like all the content. I have to prepare our kids so they can go to Harvard and Yale or wherever. And it's, I think that's the least flexible part of our system with this stuff. Unfortunately, it kills me, but I wish it was.
But here's the thing. Supposedly, if you're teaching your kids to think for themselves, to reflect, to be self-motivated and self-directed learners, once they do hit those boxes, they are going to excel in these boxes as well. And here's the thing, the hardest nuts to crack, like you say. Sometimes I have issues with you know, saying those things.
But, yeah, because you're not...
if you're documenting what you're teaching and how you're teaching and how you're learning and how your students are learning, that's how we're going to crack these nuts. We're not going to crack them by simply, okay, we're going to keep teaching to the test, so you keep going to get those kids who can fill out those bubbles. We need to be opening up and learning and self-directed and self-motivated learning and critical thinking. And in order to crack them, here's all the evidence of their learning. And we're going to do that with the documentation of it. But if we don't have documentation, we don't have, you know, I'm looking now, I'm getting obsessed by looking into, we need to be more like action researchers. We need to be more like scientists to be able to have an hypothesis. Yes, those kids can, you know, can go into the box when they need to, but they will learn so much more with us if we do it this way. And so that's our hypothesis. Now we're going to collect artifacts that will, you know, evidence that this is correct. And then we're going to share our documentation with the world to have a challenge, to have people say, hey, I'm disproving your hypothesis, or no, I'm not, and so on. I think that's the way we're going to be able, the only way, otherwise they're going to continue to teach in the box.
I think that's a perfect way to end, Silvia. This has been like tremendous. You and Peggy have really given us a lot to think about, and I hope that the other students in our class will watch this afterwards and give us some feedback. They're going to be going into a discussion forum and reflecting on this to get more points, more check boxes. But you guys have been tremendous. And Silvia, when do we think your book is coming out? When are you trying to get it done for?
I'm going to have it done by April, and then it's going to take him forever to print. It's coming out with Cohen Press.
Okay. Well, we'll look for it. It's going to be phenomenal. And yeah.
Until then, I have a website called documentingforlearning. .com. I'm going to put that in here for you. And if you are, I'm going to leave you guys with a challenge. It's a challenge I call the Blue Day Challenge. And I'm going to ask you for choose a day, pick a day, 24 hours. You don't have to be up the whole 24 hours, but look around you. Look for the color blue in your life. And take as many pictures to capture that color blue as you want to. And by the end of the day, before you go to bed, you look at all those pictures, you only get to choose one. One picture of blue. And share it with the hashtag Documenting for Learning Blue on Instagram, on Twitter, with an explanation of why is this relevant in your life, that blue. And as you do this during the day, think about, are you noticing more blues in your life? What kind of blues are you noticing? What makes you decide which pictures to choose in the end? What evidence, what is linked to, you know, what's relevant to your own life? So I'm going to drop into the chat also the blog post that explains it and gives you the hashtags as well. So that's my challenge to you for one day to do a challenge.
And this is online professional development. This is something, this kind of outside the box challenge type thing is something my students could think about how they could incorporate into their final products or their final projects. So that's brilliant. That's awesome. You guys have been fabulous. This has been a great kickoff to our webinar series. I can't remember who's coming up next week, but you all are welcome to come back for any of these. I think next week is Mike Muir, who is head of the EdTech initiatives in Maine. He's all about learning, not the technology. Really smart, lovely human being, and just like you ladies are. And so anybody's welcome to come to those, and we'll record them and put them up as well. With this particular one, I'm going to, it'll take a few minutes to process, and then I'll upload it to YouTube, and I'll post it to Facebook and things like that as well. So thank you so much, ladies. If you need me to ever do anything for you like this, I'll be happy to reciprocate and come teach something, whatever you're doing. Okay?
For now, just go to the airports when you need to.
I know. Oh my.
That'll be the biggest thank you.
You know, so I'm going to end the meeting right now. Or not end the meeting, but I want to stop recording. I don't really care if this is recorded.
Thank you, guys.